On Daf Masechtes Baba Kama Daf Tezvav, begin on Daf, begin 6 lines down at the top of the Yamed. The Gemara continues explaining the halacha of our previous Mishnah, which we had mentioned regarding qualifying the halacha of the damages. How do we go about qualifying that? And one of the items was Hanosh Mechla Hanezek Hanizik VaMazik B'Tashlumin, and the Gemara continues qualifying those enigmatic statements, as we had mentioned in the previous daf, all these interesting terminologies, shum kesef, shove kesef, bifnei bez, napibe, eidim. It was interesting how to translate what those words meant. Shiz kos paz bakazach necheskel, tenim daf achayim, everyone joined today's daf, vizchus vachayim b'nei Yisrael and Eretz Yisrael and throughout the entire world. Some of the discussed today's daf are noshim achal hanezik, that women are included in damage. First of all, where the Gemara goes through many different sources, where do we know this halacha that women are included in the halachas of damage? And the Gemara discusses why we need all those sources. The famous machlok is a palganiska, this of chatzi nezek, that you pay half the damages by shor tam. Is that because of memoina, or is that because of knasa? And that is that something that we expect and we just lean on you, or we don't expect and it's actually knasa, it's a penalty. The halacha pchas nevela comes into that discussion regarding what is that nizik v'mazik b'tashlumin. What is it that they both are participating in the payment? Is it because really Palkaniska is kanasa, is mamayna, and therefore the nizik is actually losing? He's also participating in the payment, or is it because, as we'll see, the pachas nevela, that depreciation is where the nizik participates in, so to speak, the payment of the loss? The halacha of tamu adin regarding the next mishnah begins a conversation about 5 types of tam and 5 types of muad. And the halacha of shor hamud b'shus hanizik, the halacha that an ox is considered muad, even if it's on its first times, if it's in the victim's own property. So begin the current daf tesvav, we begin 6 lines down at the top of the yamid. The Mishnah had mentioned the hanoshim mechla hanizik, the women are also liable for damages caused by their possessions. The Gemara brings 3 sources and also why we need all 3. Says the Gemara, mina anamili. From where do we know this idea that women are included in the halachas of damages? So I'm going to read the Madam, and the Chin Tan the Rebbe Shmuel is taught in the Brayse of Shiva Rebbe Shmuel. Amar Kar LaPosah is Bamidbar. Ish oy isha, a man or a woman, ki yasu mikol chatois, if they're going to do from all sins of ha'adam, of a person. So what the Pasuk is doing for us is hishva kosav isha le'ish. The Pasuk is equating a woman to a man. L'chol ha'inshin shevat teira, for all punishments of Torah. It says mikol chatois ha'adam. So we see that just like a man is going to be liable for the sin of causing damage, so too will a woman, which that's what Tesis goes to explain, that specifically where the parasha is said in the Lashon Zachar, Tesis explains why sometimes we find that we have to include a woman and other times not. But Al-Kapanim, when it says a man, definitely we would have to include a woman. And we find, says Rabbeinu Tam, that by Negicha, it says, ish, ki yigo ifshar ish, ulmuta isha, if we didn't have a rebuy for the kra, al kapanim, we have a rebuy from the pasuk, including a woman too. That's one source. Now, the Berei Belazatana, Yeshiva Belazat taught another braisa. It says the pasuk in Shemais, in Mishpatim, Ve'ela Mishpatim, Mesha Tassim Lethneim, and these are the judgments that you should place in front of them, which includes all of Klal Yisrael. Ish, vahar kasav, isha le'ish, l'chol dinish b'teira. So the pasuk is equating a woman to a man for all judgments, which nizakin is chayshem mishpat, is dinim, is judgments. Bechizki v'Rabbi Yisak l'itana, and their yeshiva taught a different brisa. Amakra, the pasuk says in Sefer Shemais v'hemis ish ayisha that they can execute it's talking about ishar nagach, that if let's say the owner didn't watch his ox a few times already, and now it kills a man or a woman. Okay, so the ox gets stoned and the owners also get executed, which doesn't mean that. It means he has to pay kaifer. But hishva kasav isha le'ish l'chol misa shabateira. See, the pasuk is equating a woman to a man for all deaths that are in the Torah. In other words, the Tesis explains in the maschal l'chol misas that they're going to be chayiv for having killed them, death or kaifer, just like on a man. Because that's what the pasuk is talking about when it says v'hemis isha isha. It's not talking about executing the man or woman. It's something that if their ox killed a man or woman, the owner of the ox is going to be liable. We see when it comes to Nizakin that the woman is the same thing as the man. It says Gemara Tzrichi, and you have to say all these 3 different sources. Why? So Gemara explains. Yes, Minikamaisa had. We had only the first source of Isha Isha Kiyasu, which is talking about a carbon. It's talking about Kiyasu Mikol Chatayis Adam. So, oh, awesome with the Chas Rachman Allah. That's where the Torah is concerned and compassionate about the woman, that she should have the halacha like a man. She should have atonement. So for that, we consider her in the same category as a man. Now, Taisus actually asks, he says, what are you talking about? If you wouldn't equate the woman to the man for punishments at all, then for sure there would have been more rachmanis, where she wouldn't get no einish and she wouldn't need a kapar at all. So says Taisus, no, we need it for einshim that explicitly written in the Torah by women, like Arayas, and that we need to tell you that they do have a kapara, that they are included in the Torah. Okay, maybe that's where I would say that the woman is like the man for a punishment that we, for the purposes of atonement. Avodinim, but let's say the second category, that's regarding judgments. I would say, no, maybe only ish, a man, devar maso matin, who he does business in, yes. But ish aloi, generally a woman is not engaged in commerce. I would say that she's not going to have the same halacha like a man. Now, v'yesh min adinim, how we say the laws of judgments, that a woman is like a man, I would tell you, okay, k'yecha t'tav l'chiyusa, because we wanted her to have a source of livelihood, because if she's not in the category of judgments, then merchants would not want to have any business with her because she's not included in the halacha of having judgments. Of a kapara, but regarding the first source of atonement, I would say, no, only ish, only a man, the bar mitzvah in, who he's someone that gets bar mitzvah, so to speak, meaning he's obligated in all the mitzvahs, so he is someone that we need to be considered for his atonement. Isha de la bas mitzvah, a woman that's not someone that's commanded in all these mitzvahs, that a man is commanded, then I would say, Lloyd, that she does not need to have this atonement. So therefore, that's why we have to include also the first source. Now, v'yishmini ha'nitarti, I'd be out of only these two sources. I would say, okay, hachol be here, mishum kapara. There is a reason why, because of atonement. V'hachol mishum chiyusa here by the second source is because of a livelihood. Aleni katala, but regarding execute, but having killed, meaning we're saying that your ox or yourself is going to be liable if you kill a woman just like a man. So maybe for that, if I didn't have the third source, I would say, ish, bar mitzvah, a man or someone who's obligated mitzvahs, so l'shalom kaifer. So then yes, then if his ox kills that person, he has to pay the atonement money to the inheritors of that person because now this man cannot fulfill mitzvahs anymore. But isha, a woman's not here to fulfill mitzvahs. That's why she exempts all mitzvahs such as mangurama. She's here to maintain the purity of the world. That's why she just can't do any loisa aset. She's not, her purpose is not devar mitzvah. A man has to be here to get somewhere, to get to the mitzvahs. A woman is created on a higher level in that way. So I would say maybe if the ox kills her, you don't have to pay kaifa. There's not a major loss for her own neshama. Again, however you explain that. But therefore, you have to say that no, Aisha will be like a man for katala too. Now, v'yeshmini kaifa, we only had the third source of atonement, shemdeke ibn neshama. I would say, yeah. So there's a loss of her soul, which some gesoys have the words add on to chas rachman Allah. So the Torah had compassion on her that to force the owner of that ox to pay kaifa money for the woman too. Avnahani tied to the first to the leke ibn neshama, was no loss of life. Emelai would say that the woman is not included in the category of dinin and not included in the category of karmen chatois. So you have to have all three sources that they're all pertinent for us, for the halacha of Nizakin. Nizakin has einshin in it, it has dinin in it, it has also the if a man or woman is killed. But in general, we need all the three sources to teach us, because you would not have known these particularities to differentiate, to say that a woman is like a man in all these three different areas. Now, the Mishnah continued and said, Hanizik v'amazik b'tashlumin. Now, when it comes to payment, interestingly, the Mishnah said that both the perpetrator and the victim both participate in the payment. So what does that actually mean? Interesting statement. So the Gemara's first going to introduce the famous machlokes of regarding how you qualify chatzi nezek, and then it's going to relate back how to translate these words in the Mishnah. Itma, we learned, pal geniska. This that we say by shor, by keren, tam, that there's something called half of the damage that you pay. So Rav Papa, he says, memoina, meaning, law would have it that you would have to compensate for the damages that your ox did even on the first time. It's not a knas. It's not a penalty. Your ox caused damage. You have to pay. Now, The ramification of this is that if you admit before witnesses come, you're not exempt. But knas, there's halacha of moed b'knas. If you admit to the penalty, you're patur. But here it's not a knas. Of course you should have to pay. Why you pay less? We're going to see in a moment that Torah has rachmanis on you. But really, it's a monetary obligation. It says no knas. It says it's a penalty. Really, you should not have to pay anything at all, as the Gemara explains. Rav Papa says it's a monetary obligation. He holds stam shvarim, unspecifically, in general, oxen, labeches kashima kayaman. Your ox is never presumed to be internally protected because they always are going crazy, these oxen, goring. You have to watch them. Now, the truth is, says the Rav Papa, ubedinu debay lishlum kuli. Really? Logic would dictate that you have to pay the whole damage. But however, Hashem, the Torah has compassion on this person. It wasn't warned already. It was the first time. You know, always that first mistake. You never realize, like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I did that. Then, okay, you were warned two times. Now already, you were supposed to pay always, but now we're going to have you've paid the full thing. But it's really a mamayna. It's really monetary obligation. Now, Rabbi Yishuami says, no, kanasa. It's not true. Really, it's a penalty because ksava hield stam shvarim and generally oxen. You don't presume if you're walking and you're taking a walk in one of these little farms and you're going for a chalamoy trip and you walk amongst the oxen, you're not expecting the ox to go, so they start goring. That's not what they do. And therefore, bedinu de lisham klal. The truth is, on the first time it does it, the second time, you shouldn't have to pay anything at all because it's like an oinus. We're not expecting this to happen. The Torah penalizes the person so that he protects his oxen just to make sure that this doesn't happen. But we're not expecting it to happen. So that's the machloek. Is it chatzi nezik mamon or is it knas? Now, the Gemara now brings it back to the halacha of our Mishnah. Frek the Gemara, tnan, we learned in our Mishnah, hanizik v'amazik b'tashlumen. The victim and the perpetrator are in the payment. Now, it sounds like that both of them are losing money when it comes for payment time. Why? Because the mazik is paying half, and the nizik is losing half. Oh, frek the Gemara, wait a second. Bishlam al-mandamor, and according to one who says, pagin nizkim amoyna, that the chatzin nizik is a monetary obligation, meaning you should have paid the whole thing. It's all mammon. It's not a monetary obligation you have. We let you off half. Ah, hain the sheikh nizik b'tshlumen, that makes sense. That the victim is participating in the payment. In other words, he's losing half of what was really coming to him. He should really take the whole thing because the mazik was negligent with his ox that he didn't watch it. And we're expecting that it should damage. Okay, Hashem has rachmanis in him. So, but that means to say that the victim is also paying forward. But according to one who holds that the chatzi nezik is a knas, hash, don't understand. Now, the love the day shakal. The half that he takes is not even coming to him. But Tashulman Isay, you think the Nizik is considered as part of the payment? Sounds like he's losing something. You're not losing anything. You weren't even supposed to get even half. So where do you have the Nizik in the Tashulman of Chatzi Nizik? Says Gimaloi Nitzchah, it's not, no, we need it. It's not a difficulty. You could say Palgan Nizke Knasa, but it's El Lepchas Nevela. It's for the depreciation of the dead carcass. That the entire depreciation of the dead animal is the loss of the victim. From the moment, the time of the damage until the court case decided, as it keeps on depreciating in value, that is the Nizik's payment that even in that kanas that the Torah gives him, he doesn't take the whole thing, he's going to be losing till the time it comes for the court case. That's the depreciation is going to be his loss. Meaning we're going to consider the mazik as if he ready, he only has to pay according to Shas HaMisa, even though when it comes time of the court case, this nevela is worth maybe half of what it was worth. Then that loss is the Nizik's loss. So therefore you have the Nizik b'tashlum and imnukam and the amapalke Nizke k'nasa. Says Gemara, really? That's what the halacha of our Mishnah is teaching. The old chatzi nezik k'nasa, when it says ha-nizik v'amaz b'tashlumen, is teaching me the halacha p'chas nevela? V'sayis p'chas nevela tana l'reisha. We already learned this in the Mishnah and of Testament Beis, that when it says chavdi b'tashlumi nizkoi, it said that I'm obligated in the supplementation of its damage, and that we learned, just say I'm liable in the nezik, in the damage. What's in the tashlume nezik? Oh, so he said, meaning the mazik doesn't have to pay a brand new animal. He just has to supplement, which means to say that the nizik gets stuck with the dead animal, and I have to pay the rest. What does that mean to say? It means the owner's got to be stuck with that, which we obviously is only telling us that whatever depreciation it has up until the court case is the loss of the victim. So I already know this from the Mishnah of Tess. Why do I need hanizik b'mazir b'tashlum to teach me this halacha? Says Gemara, chod b'tam b'chod b'mud. One is teaching me the halacha of a tam. I won't teach me the halacha of a mud b'tricha, and you need to say both why. So the Gemara explains. Yes, mina tam had we said this halacha of pchas nevel de nizik, that the loss of the depreciation is for the victim. Only by a tam, I would say, yeah, the ox didn't become a shur hamud yet. So we're not going to penalize the mazik so much to pay the pchas nevelo. Of a mood, but ready the third time, Emolei would say, no, we're going to hold the mazik liable for also the depreciation of the nevelo. And v'yashmi the mood, had we only said the teaching of pchas nevelo the nizik by a mood, I'd say, yeah, mishum de kumashalm kule. If the guy's paying the whole damages, you're not going to be so stringent on him to require him also to take on upon himself the pchas nevela of a tam, but by tam, he's only paying half. Emil, I would say maybe, no, you're only paying half. You take responsibility for the pchas nevela, the mazik, and let it not be on the nizik. So, tricha, if you have to say this halacha of pchas nevela two times the nizik, one for tam and one for mut. No, because we only had one source. So now the Gemara is asking, why do you need a second source? The Gemara is only clarifying now that you brought a second source, saying, why do you need a second source? Must be I would have thought otherwise. But there's no practice, but halachically there's no distinction. That's why both are teaching in Pachas Nevel Denizik. You might have thought, had I only told you one source, I would have thought that, yeah, maybe I would have thought, right, why didn't the Gemara say, ask it there, right, that maybe, what am I including this for everything or whatever, but akaponim, so there's not a raya. You could interpret these words of the Mishnah, now it comes that that's interesting. The words in the Mishnah, nizik b'mazik b'tashlumin, depending if you hold chatzi nezik knas or mamon, you can be translating this in very different ways. If you hold chatzi nezik as mamon, the tashlumi of the nizik is the fact that he's losing half. If you hold pagan nezik knasa, the tashlumi nizik is the halacha b'chas nevela, teaching you again either tam or mu'ud. Now the Gemara says, okay, Tashma, it's being a raya to this machlekes of chatzi nezik, it's knas a moment from a Mishnah on the next daf on Tazayin on the base. Mishnah says, ma bin tam la mu'ud. So, okay, so what's the difference between a tam and a mu'ud? So the Mishnah explains on the next daf, shatam isham chatzi nezik megufa, because there's two things. The innocent ox of the first two times pays only half the damage, and it's only from the body of the animal itself. So if let's say the animal itself was not in the mazik's animal, is not worth even half the damages, the nizik loses out, like it says in Shmoyis Chafal, v'chotzeres kaspei, that they split up half the value of the mazik's own shar, versus muid in Mashal nizik shom in aliyah. There it pays A, the whole damages, and it's from the aliyah, meaning if let's say the mazik's not worth the entire damage, so then the victim could go collect from the assets that the mazik has in his bank, in his home. Now, the Gemara, Vim Isa. Now, if it's true, like the man, the Amr that holds the chatzin nezik is a knas, listening namiha. Whoa, there's another difference. You should say that the chatzin nezik of tam is a knas, and who cares? Ein mishal mapi atzmoi. The halach is when you're moid be knas, you're potter. You don't pay a penalty on your own admission. Ooh, versus mu'id is mammon, obviously. It's a monetary obligation. Mishalma piyas, but you pay based on yourself. So vas haste, why don't you say a third difference between the tam and the mu'id if you hold chatzi nezik is a kenas? Says the Gemara, good question, but this is what's called ton of ishaya. You're right, we said differences, but we left over. We didn't say every difference. So the famous question is, my shaya da hayshaya. Well, what did you leave over that you left over? You're not leaving over one item. If you have a few things, fine, I can say the whole list. Says the Gemara, yeah, I'll tell you what else was left out. Shai chatzi kaifer. The halacha is that a mu'id, an animal that gored three times, that kills a person, the owner of that ox has to pay atonement money, what's called kaifer, to the yarshim. A tam, even chatzi kaifer, he doesn't pay. Now, you would say normally the damage that a mu'id pays, the tam pays half of that. So you would say a tam has to pay half of the atonement money. No, that was left out, that is another difference that we're saying between that of a tam and a muad, we didn't talk about the difference of that there's not even chatzik, meaning that's a difference that you don't have. Muad has kaifer and tam does not have its chatzik kaifer. Says Gemara, even shem chatzik kaifer, that's not a good thing to say that what else was left over, because lav shiuchah, that wasn't left out. Because Hamani, who's the talent of the Mishnah later on? So basically, that the Amud that he actually says, Perek Shoshanogi is the part later of Ben Bezim and Alf, that actually Tam Misham Chatzi Kaifer. Tam actually pays half the Kaifer. And therefore, it's not left over, because like Rashi explains, if you're going to say, what do you mean that is left out? Because what do you mean? Mood pays Kaifer Shalom, and Tam only pays half a Kaifer. That's not left out, because you already told me Tam pays half of the damage, Mood pays the whole thing, and Kaifer is included. So that wasn't left out. That is inherent, and I already told you that Tam is Chatzi and Mood is Shalim. So wait, what else are you leaving out? You tell me you left out, if you hold Chatzi as a Knas, if you made the Al Pi Atzmoy. So what else was left out? Not Chatzi Kaifer, because it's like Rabbi Yisi Haglili, who holds that, no, that actually is inherent already. There actually is Chatzi Kaifer. So Gemara says, Toshma, let's bring a Raya. From Mishnah Masechet Ksubos, which the Gemara says in Amud Beis, "Hey Mishayri is plainly." Let's say, meaning so essentially, the Gemara just said that to say Chatzi Nezek Knas would be difficult because what else are you leaving out that you're saying that you have ton of Mishayri, if it's because Chatzi Kaifer. So then that's not Shiur, because it's like Reis Haglili holds Tam Misham Chatzi. Taisa explains a little bit different. He says that actually, ask an Amandam Apalgin Iskim Amayna. But Al Kapon, that's the way it sounds like from Rashi, that it's a question on the Palgin Iskim Knasa, and we didn't find anything that else should be left out. The Mishnah says, okay, let's bring a right to this Machalikis of Chatzi Nezik Knas or Mammon from Mishnah Vesach Ksubas. Mishnah says, Hey Mishnah is plainly. If someone says that my ox killed that person, or that person's ox. So, he pays based on his own testimony. Oh, says the Gemara, my labetam, isn't it talking about an ox on the first time? And what the Mishnah is telling us is that my ox killed that person. He's going to pay half of the kleifer based on himself, and it's Rabbi Yisai Galili. Or the ox of that person he killed, and is going to pay based on himself chatzi nezik. But one thing we see from this is that obviously we consider chatzi nezik as mammon, because how's he paying based on his own testimony? So you see, nalik demandam apalgin is kekanasa. Must just lay no. It's talking about bemud. It's talking about where it's a sharmud. So obviously, everyone agrees to that it's mammon, and therefore you're going to pay based on your own admission. Says him, wait a second, but Tamai, wait. But if it was a Tam, what are you trying to say? Because you want to say, like, that you wouldn't pay based on your own admission? If that's the case, at the Tani Sefer, then instead of the Sefer contrasting and saying, oh, hey, Mishayris Abdishal Plaini, but if he says, my ox killed the slave of that person, now Rashi points out that killing a slave, the liability is a Knas, because you pay 30 slum, even if it's worth only one dinner. When there's a precise amount, obviously, that's not a monetary liability, because that depends on how much damage it is. That's a knas. Oh, then says the Mishnah, Im b'shalma piyatzmi. And then he's not going to pay based on his own, because it's ma'idah b'knas. But if that's the case, liflik b'lisni b'didei, you could have differentiated in the first case itself. In hei mishayri, in saying that my ox killed that person's ox, you could have differentiated. You could have said, b'medvim, when did I say this? That when you admit, you can be chayiv as b'muid, when they did it three times. But Tam, when it's on its first times, you don't pay based on yourself, because why come on to a different case of killing a slave when you could have said it in Shoyre Shal Acher? So that's not difficult, because Kul B'Mu'ud Kamayri. The Mishnah is only talking about Mu'adim, and they wanted to let us know, Chilukim in Mu'ud, that even by Mu'ud itself, there are differentiations when you're not going to pay based on yourself, for example, when it's the 30 Shkolim of an Eved. But regarding Tam, yeah. There are that they're also not going to pay based on yourself, but we weren't talking about Mu'ud. Okay, so it's no raya. It's more Toshma, it's being a raya from that same Mishnah. The Mishnah there says, Zah, called this the rule, Whoever pays more than what he damaged, for example, let's say when you pay 30 shkolim for an eved, where he could have been worth just one dinar, you're going to pay 30 shkolim, that you're paying more than what the damage is, which is essentially what we call kanas. You're not going to pay based on your own admission. Okay, but the Gemara makes an interesting diik. My love, your words were, if it's yoisa masha hizik. But doesn't that tell us, ha-pachis mimasha hizik? But if you're paying less than what the damage was, for example, the chatzi nezik of tam, that when you admit, then misham, then you will pay based on yourself. Ooh, that shows me that chatzi nezik is mammon. Why are you saying, if you pay more than masha hizik? That tells me, but if it's less than masha hizik, then you would pay based on yourself. Well, that proves chatzi nezik is mammon, not knas. Says Gemara, no. The dig should be hakamasha hizik, but if it's like exactly how much your damage was, like the nezik shalom of amud, then misham, then you pay. But says Gemara, wait a second. I'm a pachas mai. So what are you telling me? But if it's less than hachinam le misham, then you're right there also. If you admit on your own, you're not going to pay. Yeah, if that's the case, at the tani, instead of saying zakal, there's the rule. Kol misham yisamasha hizik. Whoever pays more than what he damages. In the Mishalma Piyat's not going to pay based on himself. Why don't you say a better terminology? Listen, you should have said, Zahaklal, this is the rule. Kol she'in Mishalma Kamasha Hizik, whoever does not pay exactly as he damaged, the Mashma Pachas and Mashma Yaisa. That would understand whether less or more, then you're not going to pay based on your own admission because that's Knas. Says Gemara Tiyufta, you're right, that definitely it's a refutation. And that obviously, that if you're moida by chatzin nezik, you are going to be chayiv, because it's mammon. It's only if you're yoisa masha hizik, but pachis, you would be chayiv, because chatzin nezik is mammon. But the Gemara says, what's going to throw us for a loop, v'hilchasa halacha is pagin is k'knasa. Chatzin nezik is knas. The Gemara says, tiyufta v'hilchasa? You just refuted, you showed me from the diak that less than what you damage, if you admit you're going to pay, which obviously infers that chatzin nezik is mammon. And then you go and you tell me that halacha is palganizka is kanasa. Says Gemara, and yes, because time of mahabatiyufta, why was it a refutation? Mishum delikatani, because like we said, it doesn't say kamoisha hizik. That if it's not exactly that you admitted to how much you damage, oh, so then you're going to be pater. It doesn't say that. So obviously, if it's less, like we said, because you are going to be chayiv if you admit. Says the Gemara, that's not a tiyufta. Because le psikale, it's not clear cut to say the words kamasha hizik, that only then will you be chayiv if you admit. Because that would sound like we're saying, that if it's less than how much you damaged, then you wouldn't pay based on your own. It's not true. Why not? Because it's not the only chatzin nezik by Karen. Because kivin nikah chatzin nezik tzrei reis. There's another chatzin nezik by the pebbles when the animal is walking. There, you also don't pay how much the damage was. And there, even so, you will pay based on your own admission. Why? Because the hilchas of gemira lo tzalocha mesh mesina dememoinahu. Tzrei reis is considered a telada of regel, which is mammon, which is not knas. Ah, mishamachel leketani. So therefore, he couldn't say kamasha hizik, that's when you admit that you're going to be chayiv, which would infer that, oh, if it's more or less, then you're going to be pater. Because that would make sense for Karen. But for Tzrei Reis, that would sound like also that it's, since it's less than how much you damage that you would be pater if you admit. But that's not true. Because Tzrei Reis, you're chayiv if you admit. Ah, it's why you're paying chatzin nezik. That's a halacha mesh mesina. So we couldn't say kamasha, we had to say yoisa masha hizik. To infer, but if it's less, then sometimes actually you would be chayiv if you admit. By Tzroiris, but could be by Karen, you're right, would be Pater. So if it's not a contradiction, does not refute the Malda Amma, who says Chatzin Nezik is Knas. So says the Gemara, okay, Hashtam, now that you're saying Pagan is Knasa, which the Gemara seems to be paskening that, okay, Chatzin Nezik is Knas, really, we should not be Mechayev you because we stam Shvarim Abaches Kashim Kaimi, but just we penalize you to be careful. So then comes that Hai Kalbu de Ochel Imri, this dog that eats lambs. Or if you have a cat that eats a rooster, that's unusual. It's not normal. And therefore, like Rashi says, like we mentioned previously, one of the characteristics of Karen is that it's mishunah, it's unusual, it's not the norm. Therefore, you pay chatzi nezek. Now, hence would be v'leim megvin mebavel. We would not make such a collection in bavel because the halacha is you don't judge dina knasas only by people that have smicha. Like the Gemara says in Sanhedrin of Ches. And by bavel, there's no smicha, as the Gemara says over there in Sanhedrin of Yudalad, only in Eretz Yisrael. And therefore, in bavel, they don't dan dina knasas. So if you have a mishuna diga oifen over here where they're doing something unusual, you're not going to be able to make such a collection. Now, the Gemara qualifies v'anamil b'ravrivi. That's only by huge roosters and very large lambs. That's not normal for the dog and for the cat to kill them. A bezuchi, if they're small, so it could be normal that a dog would go ahead and maul and eat up this small baby lamb. And therefore, then you would don such a thing. It wouldn't be Karen. It wouldn't, because it's not Mishunah. Now, moreover, says the Gemara, be toughest if the victim in Bavel, who even though it's Mishunah, it's Karen, if he grabs to collect from the mazik, lamb of Kimene, we don't extract the monies from him. Now, moreover, let's say the nizik does not snatch, but Amar, he says, coverly zimna, I want to make a date, that's lina la'agad yisod, that we're going to go up to Eretz Yisrael, because that's where they're going to paskin on dinik knasis. So kavinle, we establish for him this obligation of the mazik to go up with him to Eretz Yisrael, to have this din taira, to dan for this dinik knasis. And ve'iloy azel, and if the mazik doesn't go, meshamtinle, we excommunicate him. We put him in chayim for not going. It says the Gemara, benkach, anyway, meshamtinle, we put a ban on the mazik to kill this dog or this cat that's obviously terrorizing these lambs and these chickens. At the mesalik hazeka, until he removes this damaging dog, meaning that he has to neutralize this dog. Why? Because the Tanya will learn the Bryce of, he says, Menayin, how do you know Shalei God Baldim Kelab Rabbatech Beis? A person should not bring up a bad dog in his house, which actually was a story, I think, in Lakewood just yesterday, some pit bull, whatever, some kid was injured. You're not supposed to have a bad dog in your house. Well, Yamitzul Mirubatech Beis, and he shouldn't have a shaky ladder in his house. Tamalayma, where do we know that from? Buzzing the Varab, Sassan Dam Beisach, you should not place blood in your house. So anyway, says the Gemara, forget about that. We excommunicate him if he does not want to have the din taira in there itself. Stamazer, we put him in chayim until he gets rid of this dog, rid of this cat that's terrorizing. And that's what they have, a kelev ra, b'tech beisei shalom. Right, that's stamazer. That's what I'm saying. Benkach and benkach. Right, but that's in general. Well, that's regarding Malva and Loiva. Here, regarding the halachas. Right, but they don't dandy in the knasses out of Eretz Yisrael. So there's no choice but to go up to Eretz Yisrael. Now the next Mishnah continues this theme about damage and about monetary payment. So says the Mishnah, Chamisha Tam and Chamisha Mu'adin. There are five types of Tam, and there's five types of Mu'ad, as the Mishnah explains. Habehema in a Mu'adis, the animal is not a Mu'ad, meaning it's only going to be a Tam. Loy Ligach means not a Mu'ad to gore with its horns. Loy Ligach, not to push with its body. I mean, these are all derivatives, they're all Toladis of Karen, which you pay Chatzin Ezek, and they're all Tamin. It's considered innocent, meaning it doesn't pay the full damage. And that is v'lei lishach, not to bite, v'lei libet, not to squat, v'lei libet, not to kick. That's tamen. Now, versus hashein, mu'edes, if an animal to eat something, it's considered a mu'ed, lechel asarola, to eat what's a fit for it. So to haregel mu'edes, the regel is mu'ed where it breaks something as it's walking, is lishba b'deir chilucha, it's normal for it, it's considered already pre-warned to break when it's walking. And you have v'shur ha-mu'ed, which is, if you have an ox that three times gored or pushed with his body or squatted or kicked or bit, these are five mu'adin that would have to pay nezik shalom, which regarding mu'ad, we're considering as one, because it's through the warning of the witnesses that you come to a liability of nezik shalom. So it's all considered as one entity, these five teladis of Karen. And you have b'shur ha-mazik, b'shur ha-nezik. You have the damager's ox in the victim's property. So there, even Karen Tam is going to be like a mu'ud to pay nezek shalom. And the fifth muid is Adam, is man, which are five, which we're talking about living creatures, and therefore we don't count Boyer and Eish that are also muid mitzchalas. So later on the Gemara is going to ask, but why don't we count in the five those which the Mishnah is going to say right now, the lion and the bear, etc. But those are five. You have Shein, Regel, Shor HaMuad, Shor HaMazik B'Shus HaNizik, and Adam, those five are Muadim. And then the Mishnah continues, Hazev, the wolf, Vari, and the lion, Vadoiv, and the bear, Vanomar, and the leopard, Vabardalus, which the Gemara is going to explain what Bardalus is, Vanochash, and the snake, Hareel Muadim. They're all Muadim, meaning, even let's say for Karen, let's say biting, and in all damagings, the owners are going to have to pay Nezik Shalom. Even though generally we say for, let's say, for an ox, it'll be tam. For these types of creatures, we always consider them right away that you're responsible. You should have. They're not shmiras nola. They're not inherently in stam shomer, and you would have to watch them. And every chayv nezik shalom. Lozami says, well, it depends. Bismachim ben etarbis, when they are domesticated, when they are trained to be polite, inim adam, then they're not really a muad. But vanachash mu'ud la'adam, a snake is always going to be considered as a mu'ud. I think Mara says, from the fact that we learned Hashem mu'ed is lachol, the teeth, the animal's desire to eat, is considered a mu'ud to eat. Mechlav, the inference is, the b'chatzah nizik askin, obviously we have to be talking about the victim's property, because we know shein regel is only chayev b'shus hanizik. Now, k'tani, we learned in the Mishnah that behemo einu mu'edis, an animal is not a mu'ud for goring or for pushing with its body, which is keren. L'shalem kulei, to pay all of the damages, but the inference is meaning al chatzin nezik mishlamis, but it will pay half the damage. So you see that Karen b'chutzar hanizik is paying only chatzin nezik. Well, says the Gemara, well, mani, so who would the Mishnah be like? Rabban, he would be like the Rabban. And I mean that they say mishun the Karen b'chutzar hanizik, a deviant act which is under the category of Karen in the victim's property, it's still chatzin nezik the mishlam. You only pay half the damages. Problem is, Emes Sefer, look later on the Mishnah. When it's talking about the list of the five mu'adin, it says shor hamu'ud, and it says v'shor hamazik v'shus hanizik. The mazik's ox in the victim's property, even on the first times, is going to be a mu'ud, and v'adim and man. Well, asan Reb Tarfin. That's like Reb Tarfin, because the Amar he says mishun the keren b'chatz hanizik. When you have the mishun of keren in the victim's property, nezik shal mu'udir misham. You pay the full damages. So they should abon the b'sefer Reb Tarfin. So what, the beginning of the Mishnah is the Rabban and the end is Reb Tarfin? There's Gemara in, and we already quoted this, we referenced this Gemara on the previous daf. Yes. Leave the Mishnah, come after me, meaning don't try to be Miyashav according to one Tana. Reish Rabbanan, but Sefer Reb Tarfin. The Reish is like the Rabbanan, and the Sefer is Reb Tarfin. The Gemara on the next daf is going to attempt to say that it's all Reb Tarfin, but I'll come upon him. Now the Gemara wants to answer that, yeah, it's going like two different Tana. Thank you to any time. Those things.